use the spam for my email, so I need to.
Ladies and gentlemen, dear researchers, dear colleagues and friends, I still very briefly the mic to Judge Silvia Fernández de Gurmendi. She will excuse my French accent for her name. And to tell you how pleased I am to welcome her at the Institute. In fact, we had such a nice chat in my office together with Barbati and Martina, who contributed to set up this lecture, that we wondered whether it would be worth coming here. But at the end of the day, we thought that maybe you would be sad not to see us, so we crossed the building. And indeed, I'm very pleased and grateful that you accepted our invitation. We reflected how to have a landmark for the Max Planck Institute in relation to the 20th anniversary of the International Criminal Court. And then Martina and Parvati came with this very nice idea of having Judge Silvia Fernández de Gurmendi, who has been judge sitting at the ICC from 2010 to 2018, and she has been president from 2015 to 2018, to come at the Institute and share with us her experience in these positions, especially as she has been very much involved in the working groups on procedural rules. And so if I just name the various on which she has been sitting, beyond being the president, she has been president of the working group of criminal procedure and vice president of the committee of the whole at the Rome conference. And she has also chaired the working group of rules of procedure and evidence and the working group on digression. No need to say that she has played in these positions and capacities a major role in setting up the procedural rules at the ICC, and in this institute we are all fully conscious how important setting up the rules is. So beyond these elements that I've already put forward, I was delighted to see that she had studied art in France, having studied of course in Argentina, and also that before becoming judge at the ICC, she has been director general for human rights at the Ministry of Foreign Affairs in Argentina, and in this capacity has been in place before the Inter-American Commission and the Inter-American Court of Human Rights. So I will not multiply the biographical aspects. You have a biography on our website. But you can be prepared to a fascinating lecture on this setup of the criminal procedure at the International Criminal Court. And I thank you for welcoming her warmly. Thank you very much.
Good afternoon to all of you. I would like to start by thanking Professor Fabri for her kind invitation to address you here today on the occasion of the 20th anniversary of the Rome Statute. I understand I was invited because I thought I was 20 years old. Actually, I'm not, but I've been involved in the ICC matters for almost more than 20 years, because I was involved in the entire negotiations of the Rome Statute and the rules of procedure and evidence that were negotiated after the Rome Conference. Then I was I joined the court in 2003 to be part of the Office of the Prosecutor at the inauguration days of the court, at the times when the Office of the Prosecutor were only three individuals. And the prosecutor, and then so it was really a pioneering experience that I enjoyed very much. And then I came back as a judge, and that gave me the extraordinary opportunity to apply, or seek to apply, this procedural scheme that we had negotiated in Rome and after Rome. And as a judge, and then elected president of the court in the final 3 years of my mandate, I had this extraordinary opportunity also to tackle some initiatives, or to lead in some initiatives in order to enhance the efficiency of the court and efficiency of the proceedings. I was very fortunate because I joined the court at the time where the court was really reaching judicial maturity. And it was a huge workload for the judges, because at the beginning it was very much about the prosecutor investigating, selecting situations, selecting cases. But by the time I joined the court in 2010, this was starting to bear fruit, and we were having then the opportunity for the judges to really step in the process. So I was very fortunate to join the court at that time. But of course, it was also the time where worries about the court and the speed or lack of speed of the court were growing. And so when I joined the court, we were already trying to face these problems. The entire court was trying to improve its performance, but it was also the time for the judges to look into these procedures to see how we could expedite judicial proceedings. Just to tell you one number, when I by the time I joined the court, there was no one conviction at the court yet. We had not finished one case. By the time I left, we have 9 convictions and acquittal. There are 3 ongoing trials at this point in time, and more is in the pipeline. So the court is indeed reaching a judicial maturity, and it was really high time to seek to improve the quality of the justice we deliver. So I'm going to give you an idea. I will try to tackle the 3 phases: the negotiations of this procedural scheme, because it itself quite telling and also quite important to understand some of the problems that we're having now. Then I will tell you about the application by the judges of the system. Then I will also go into trying to describe some of the initiatives that were taken to enhance efficiency and effectiveness of the institution, and then of course some of the challenges ahead. So let's go to the drafting of the procedures in the process of negotiating the Rome Treaty, Rome Statute, and also the negotiations after Rome. Because the negotiations of the procedures do not stop at the Rome Conference, they continue beyond Rome. Now, in order to understand the process, we need to understand some of the key choices that were made by the drafters. And I was part of those drafters, although I wasn't particularly keen in the choice. But the choice that was made was, first of all, that the court would apply state-made law. In the early days of the negotiating process, the drafters of the Rome Statute made a number of fundamental choices, and one which is really has had a huge impact for the development of the court, and the first one is this one. They decided that both the substantive and the procedural law of the ICC, of the International Criminal Court, would be not drafted by the judges, but drafted entirely and adopted entirely by states. And then second choice, and I come back to these choices, they decided that while substantive law would be based on the codification of existing customary law, they decided that for the procedural framework, they would create an entirely new system, a hybrid new system resulting from the combination of elements of legal systems of the world, in particular the civil law and the common law systems. So as a corollary of these choices, state representatives embarked on a complex codification and legislative exercise that led, inter alia, to the drafting of a fairly comprehensive and very detailed procedural scheme that was included in the Rome Statute and later in the Rule for Procedural Evidence. And as I said, the procedural system in the Rome Statute ends in Rome. The procedural system of the Rules of Procedure, they are drafted after Rome in a preparatory commission, and the rules were adopted in 2002. And as I said, and Professor Fabri mentioned, I presided over the entire exercise. So I presided over the entire exercise of drafting of the rules within the statute and the rules of the rules of procedure and evidence. Now, the decision of states to draft themselves the procedure of the court was indeed a choice. It was not obvious, and actually it was totally unprecedented choice, that departs completely from the practice of other international tribunals. The statutes for the ad hoc international criminal tribunals that preceded the Rome Statute, which is the ad hoc tribunal for former Yugoslavia and Rwanda, both had left the judges the task of adopting and drafting and adopting the rules of procedure and evidence. And even beyond this sphere of international criminal law, if you look at the statutes of the International Criminal Court of Justice, the International Tribunal for the Law of the Sea, for instance, they also provide, in identical terms, that the court and the tribunal should frame the rules for carrying out their functions, and in particular, they say, they should lay down the rules of procedure. So the choice that for the ICC, it would be states doing this, we seem to take this for granted now, but actually it is the first tribunal that followed this path. And I can say that this decision was based on, one, it was argued that the procedural scheme had to be very detailed in order to conform to the principle of legality. It seems that the statutes of the ad hoc tribunals, they are very not very detailed, and it was feared that if were to really adhere to the principle of legality, both the substantive and the procedural law had to be expressed in more detail in the system. Second, I think it was also fear of a potential overreach by the judges of an international criminal court of a general and permanent character. And here is not so much about the law, but it's a policy decision that results from the tension between internationalism and sovereignty, that is a tension that has permeated the entire negotiations of the Rome Statute. So based on these two ideas, this tension on one hand and this idea of the principle of legality on the other, many supported the idea that this drafting of the procedural and substantive law was really a prerogative of sovereign national states. Many others supported the other idea that the principle should lay only general principles of law, and that the details should be left to the judges. Trust the judges. I was the group that wanted to give more flexibility to the judges, but the compromise that we see is that indeed states adopted the entire procedural scheme. At the beginning, some of those who wanted this approach that the states would draft everything, they wanted everything to be in the statute. So they really advocated for the entire procedural scheme with all the details to be in the Rome Statute. That would have delayed the creation of the court very much. And actually there was this, this sentiment that maybe that was behind this idea. So when I say compromise, the compromise was that indeed, the states will draft the entire system, but it would not be all done before the Rome Conference, which was materially impossible anyway, but a part would go into the Rome Statute and more details would be drafted later in a complementary instrument. So it was decided then that it would be three tiers of instruments, one the Rome Statute, the other one the Rules of Procedure and Evidence to be drafted later, and a third one, which is the regulations of the court, that was the only instrument that was left to the judges. That the judges would only draft these regulations for the routine functioning of the court, such as number of pages that you need in filing, how you file a document, how many days you have to respond. So that is the routine functioning. And even there, some involvement for states was allowed, because even for the regulations of the court, the judges do draft the regulations, and then these regulations are adopted and they are in effect, but they have to be circulated to states. And and they only remain in force if 2/3 majority of states do not object, which has not happened, but still this was left for the states. So we have these three instruments. In the Rome Statute, you have the procedural scheme mostly, not exclusively, but mostly in parts 5, 6, and 8 of the statute, which deal respectively with pretrial, part 5, trial, part 6, and appeals, part 8. The rules of procedure and evidence are broader, because the rules of procedure and evidence are not just about procedure and evidence, but also deal with institutional issues, the organization of the court, cooperation matters, so it's broader. It really complements the entire Rome Statute. And also the regulations of the court are broader than was expected, because indeed the judges did not, the regulations were adopted, the first draft was adopted in 2003 when the judges were elected, and the judges did not confine themselves only to the number of pages. And actually, some of the regulations are extremely substantive. See, trust the judges. they created two offices that are extremely important, which is the Office of Public Counsel for the Defense and the Office of Public Counsel for Victims, so OPCD and OPCD. They included a regulation 55, which I mentioned because I come back to this, which is a regulation that allows the judges to change the legal characterization of crimes and modes of liability proposed by the prosecutor. And they also created, through the regulations, a body that is extremely important as well, which is the Advisory Committee on Legal Text, which is the committee that deals with amendments to the statute. To the rules and the regulations. Now, both the rules and the regulations are subordinated to the statute, of course. There is a pyramid, and of course, the statute is the founding treaty of the court, is the highest instrument, and the rules and the regulations need to be subordinated to them. Actually, there was a little bit of paranoia, I would say, when the negotiations of the rules started after Rome, because there was this fear that the negotiation of the rules would be used to reopen some sensitive issues of the Rome Treaty, of the Rome Statute. So there was this fear, because of course the negotiations of the Rome Statute had been quite complicated and controversial, even on procedural matters. So there was this fear to reopen. And actually, if you read the introduction to the rules that was negotiated and approved, it says 20 times this is subordinated to the Rome Treaty. The rules are subordinated to the Rome Treaty, and in case of discrepancy, the statute shall be made. Now, actually, the rules of procedure were indeed used to fix some problems, and some issues of quite a sensitive nature. For instance, there was a proposal put forward by the United States to fix or to clarify Article 12.3 of the Rome Statute. Article 12.3 of the Rome Statute is a provision that allows a non-party to accept the jurisdiction of the court, to make a declaration accepting the jurisdiction of the court. So there was this fear that some states would use this provision to accept jurisdiction of the court over some crimes related that may be committed by an enemy state, but of enemy or the nationals of an enemy, but not other crimes that may be committed by its own nationals. So in order to fix this issue, there was a rule saying that a state that declares, accepts the jurisdiction of the court, it is to be understood that this acceptance relates to all crimes within the situation and that the state cannot pick and choose. So it was an important clarification, a fair one, but indeed it was trying to fix the problem of the Rome Statute. And there were other issues as well, that really the rules were used to improve in certain ways the Rome Statute, things that were not really thought through at the time of the finalization of the Rome Treaty in Rome, and it was not very clear how they would operate. The rules actually were used to clarify this. Now, as I said, there was this choice, a system created by state, a detailed system created by states and imposed to the court as applicable law. So there was indeed this potential risk that this would impose on the future institution a very comprehensive and untested legal system that may operate as a straitjacket and may not be workable. We were inventing the system. So there was this agreement, and this is part of the compromise, that the system or the procedure to amend the rules would be more flexible than the procedure for amending the statute. So accordingly, you have one article in the statute, Article 51, that allows amendments to be proposed, amendments to the rules, not only to be proposed by state parties, but also by the judges or the prosecutor. So it gives some involvement to the court. The court cannot amend the rules by itself, but the judges and the prosecutor can propose amendments to be adopted by states. And these amendments can be accepted and adopted by states by a two-thirds majority. So this procedure is more flexible than the amendments for the statute that is very, very complicated and requires a higher majority. This one is simpler in theory. As I will tell you, and this is important because we have tested this system in order to enhance the procedural scheme. In practice, it has become extremely difficult to amend the rules because states have decided to function by consensus. But I come back to this. So, first choice, state-made law. Second choice, hybrid law. As I said, we invented a system that is a combination of common law and civil law, which was in itself a very fascinating exercise. Imagine a room bigger than this one, full of lawyers. Can you imagine? Full of lawyers representing all countries of the world and drafting and negotiating together, because it was a really open-ended negotiation, deciding on the procedural scheme of the future court. And each one of them explaining to the rest how wonderful their own system was and how terrible the other one was. So you had a real clash of civilization between proponents of the civil law and the common law system. And it took really months or years to really start getting the idea that actually both systems can work, that both systems can provide fair treatment to the accused, and that it was important for a universal, or a court with universal aspirations, to really try to reflect systems and traditions of all world. you could not have a court that would identify with one set of values, with one legal system. You really need to reflect all these systems of values and law. And there was already this criticism of the ad hoc tribunal for former Yugoslavia, for instance, that was criticized for to be considered to be too much a common law type of approach to international criminal law. So there was a deliberate effort to depart from that and to try to have a hybrid where everybody could be represented. Well, that is a nice principle to say, but it's extremely difficult to really achieve. And actually, already the International Law Commission, which is the one that drafted the first draft for the Rome Statute, is very interesting because one of the current judges at the ICJ, the National Court of Justice, is James Crawford. He was the one presiding over the working group on procedures of the International Law Commission, the one that was dealing with the project of the ICC. And he had written about it. Here, now we read this thing. He said, the commission, the discussions were very difficult because, I said, they had to contend with the tendency of each duly socialized lawyer to prefer his own criminal justice systems and values and institutions. So that, what we already, he already noticed at the International Law Commission, we had it multiplied by 20 times at the negotiations of the Rome Statute. Every socialized, newly socialized lawyer in the room tended to prefer his or her own system. So to do this blend was extremely, extremely difficult. But we ended having a system that indeed combines both. And you have to go through the entire system to see this combination. But just to give a few examples where the where we see some very, very important institutions is, for instance, one is the introduction of a pre-trial chamber at the International Criminal Court. And I will come back to this because this is one of the key aspects of the procedure and actually is something that we really need to deal with as a priority basis in order to enhance efficiency. There is this pre-trial that was introduced in the system, which doesn't exist in the other tribunal, and is loosely inspired in civil law systems. Basically, it comes from proposals from France who wanted to have something like a chambre d'instruction, which was absolutely not acceptable for the other half of the world or the other half of the room. But eventually there was this idea that indeed there was an acceptance that you needed some kind of chamber that would do some oversight over the prosecutor, would not investigate itself as a chambre d'instruction does, but it would do some oversight of the investigation done by the prosecutor, which in the system is the one that does it in the ICC system. So the prosecutor will investigate, but this pre-trial chamber would have some powers to oversight the investigation. Some powers, and I will come back to that. It would not be an investigative chamber itself. And actually, it was one of the most contentious aspects in the discussions, to the point that up to the very last minute in Rome, we didn't know how to call this chamber. So it was called Chamber X. So no chance destruction, every time something like that would be said, it would be really a terrible discussion. So eventually, the Chamber X became the pre-trial chamber that has huge powers, in the sense that it's the one that confirms charges, does some oversight on the investigation by the prosecutor, deals most of the time with the complementarity issues. I remember that the court, the ICC, is complementary to national institutions, so it's basically the pre-trial that looks into admissibility of cases. It's the one that confirms the charges of the accused that go to trial. And that's many other things, including dealing with some investigative activities at the beginning. So this pre-trial chamber was indeed very, very important. Another institution that is extremely important as a huge innovation in the system is the participation to victims. Victims in the ICC, for the first time, were accorded the right to participate in the proceedings and seek reparations. Again, it comes mostly from civil law proposals, but it doesn't go as far as a system could be in civil law systems where you really have victims as participants. Here, the victims have a role. They can express views and concerns, but they are not, they cannot really lead the process. And they can seek reparations. So this was introduced in the Rome Statute. And I'm mentioning these two, first because they are very big ideas, and because they had a huge impact in the developments of the court later on. Now, this is the negotiations, Rome Statute. We end in Rome with consensus approval of all the procedural provisions. The Rome Statute at the end was adopted by a vote because some states requested to vote over the statute. But actually, everything that relates to procedure, we had managed to have an agreement by consensus. So there was broad agreement on everything that was written in the Rome Statute. And it was after Rome, after the adoption of the Rome Statute, the rules and procedure were drafted in this new preparatory commission. They were adopted in 2002. 2003, we elected the judges. The judges adopted the regulations of the court, and the entire procedural system was finished, and it was the time to apply it. So let's go from the drafters to the judges to see what happened with this system that was invented in Rome and after Rome. Well, this is extremely interesting, and it was very interesting for me in particular, having been not too long ago in part of the drafters, then I was part of the judges. And in every single chamber, I would see how some of the same discussions that we had had in Rome and after Rome were brought by the judges. And here we have the judges coming from different backgrounds, common law, civil law, raising these discussions and actually also trying to explain to the others that their system is much better. So it was really a deja vu for me. It was a real deja vu. And actually I could also see how in time also judges started to accept that, okay, we need to apply the Rome system, which is not my system, it is not your system. Still is very difficult. Because again, duly socialized lawyers tend to not only think their system is better, they tend to interpret the provisions in accordance with their own system. So, and some of the provisions, even if it is very detailed, they are very detailed, but still you have a lot of open provisions that really need to be interpreted and need to be applied by the judges. So many of them are, you can read them in different ways, and you will tend to read them depending on your own system. So it is not surprising then that in the first years of the operation of the court, we could see how different chambers gave completely different answers and sometimes really even contradictory responses to the same procedural issues. So that was really a problem. First, the procedures became extremely slow, cumbersome, divergent, and of course, this was one of the factors that led to a lot of delays in the court's proceedings, which were increasingly being criticized by the external world. So it was absolutely essential to search for solutions to this. And there, there was actually a very structured type of solution, because there was already the judges realizing that we needed to do do something about it, but also states. So there was this structured dialogue between courts and state in order to discuss how to enhance the system. The states, they created a working group that is called the Study Group on Governance, and the court created a group that was called a group on lessons learned. And I was part of the working group on lessons learned. We were supposed to look at the 10 first years of operations and draw lessons and propose solutions. Actually, there was a huge pressure from states that we would propose amendments. All of a sudden, they wanted amendments to their own system. So we created the group, and we identified at the court, and we proposed a roadmap that had clusters of issues that needed to be addressed, and which identified which was the most problematic parts of their own system. And part of this, on a priority basis, was pretrial, the transition from pretrial to trial that took months, and issues of victims, issues of participation. And we also proposed some amendments, because there was a huge pressure for us to propose amendments. You know, all of a sudden, there was this idea that we have a problem, we fix it with amendments. So we did propose some amendments. Actually, the first amendment, I proposed it together with a French judge, Judge Cotte. We proposed as a solution to expedite some of the proceedings at the trial phase, we proposed to basically get rid of other judges. Well, not really. We had, in pre-trial, you have, every chamber is constituted of three judges, but there is, most of the proceedings can be carried out by a single judge, the pre-trial phase. But in trial, the entire functions of trial need to be conducted by three judges. And we saw that was a problem. I mean, it was a routine function, and you see that for every single procedural step, whether to accept to give an extension of time limit or time of extension of pages, or even whether we have a hearing on Monday or Tuesday, you would need to consult three judges. So we said it would be much faster than all the preparation of the trial until the trial starts, which may take months, because you need to give orders to protect witnesses, you need to establish a system of disclosure of evidence, you need to take all kinds of procedural decisions. We propose as an amendment that for the trial, we would also have a single judge. So that was the first proposal. It was very, very modest, and it was incredibly controversial. And there we could see the difficulties of amending the system. Eventually, the proposal was amended, it was adopted, but it was extremely complicated, and it was also a good demonstration of what would come later. Because we proposed other amendments which were more substantive, and it became increasingly difficult. For instance, there is an amendment that was adopted that seeks to mitigate morality at the ICC. The entire criminal process of the ICC is based on the principle of orality. You have hearings where the arguments are heard, where the evidence is presented, and where you examine and cross-examine witnesses. All this is oral, all this is public, and this is supposed to be extremely important for fairness, but also for the public. You can go, you can participate, and you can hear all these hearings. But that also, we identify this as one element that was also slowing down the process, in particular the examination of witnesses, which takes a lot of time. We are talking about hundreds of witnesses. And also, in addition to the time, is extremely also sensitive. Lots of these witnesses need to be protected. You can do the protection in different ways. You can distort the image, for instance, so the public cannot see the witness. You can redact the names, but sometimes that's not good enough. You need to relocate, you need to take more intrusive measures. So we propose another this advisory committee on legal text, discussed, composed with judges, prosecutor, and the registrar. They propose some amendments in order to allow some, and this is also from civil law inspiration, because the examination and cross-examination of witnesses is very common law, a very common law system. Here we propose that certain instances in which you could accept the prior recorded testimony of the witness. In other words, you would not need to question the witness, you would accept the written statement. In certain instances that are well defined, of course, and one of them is the most difficult one, you could do this when there were fears of corruption, of interference of jurors. And this is extremely interesting, because the idea is that if you fear that the witness was interfered with by a third party, state, or group, then, and then for instance, the witness says the opposite of what they said before, then in certain circumstances you could accept the written testimony that the witness gave before the alleged interference. So this is a huge proposal that was introduced and of course quite resisted by some states. So this became quite a controversial issue at the state parties. So each new amendment was extremely difficult to adopt. It became extremely, the Assembly of State Parties has become an increasingly politicized environment. So the way or the path of trying to enhance the procedures of the ICC through amendments proved to be extremely cumbersome and difficult and not necessarily very efficient. Because these amendments were adopted and they are used today and they are extremely helpful. Actually, the time of the questioning of witnesses in the courtroom has been reduced by 50% thanks to this system. In many cases, the prior testimony is accepted because both parties accept it, so it's, we go faster. But still, what we saw is that if you really wanted to improve the system, you had to go not in a piecemeal approach where you try to find a thing here, a thing there, but really approach each phase of the procedure in a more holistic approach, I would say. So we did this. The working group on lessons learned continued to function. We really proposed some amendments, but in parallel, chambers started to look into certain problems and try to fix it through jurisprudence and not through amendments. And this was something that I was personally involved as well, because we did some of these initiatives. I was in pre-trial at the time, and the two pre-existing pre-trial chambers, we tried a new approach in our system through jurisprudence in order to expedite the proceedings and the pre-trial. Now, let me explain very briefly how is the system, how you get into pre-trial. First, you have the investigation. Investigation is done by the prosecutor. The prosecutor is the one selecting the situation. Let's say the Democratic Republic of Congo, there is an investigation there. She selects the cases. That is, which are the persons that are going to be indicted, although we don't have indictments. But anyway, that is going to be accused before the chamber. So, when the prosecutor considers that there is a reasonable grounds to believe that a person has committed this crime, she brings this to the pre-trial chamber to seek an arrest warrant from the court, because that has to come from the judges, or if the person is willing to come voluntarily, a summons to appear. We don't have indictments. You have an arrest warrant or a summons to appear. So this is done with a very low evidentiary threshold. You could do it on the basis of a reasonable grounds to believe. making a long story short, imagine the court has said yes, issues the arrest warrant, an even shorter story, the person is arrested and transferred to the court. Something that already, in some cases, has taken 10 years, but I will not go into that. Arresting is really one of the main challenges of the court, but we have arrested individuals, the person is arrested, brings the person is transferred, the person appears before the pre-trial judges. This is the chamber dealing with them. So, the person is arrested, appears before the chamber, then there is a confirmation hearing. There is a process that starts where the charges are going to be confirmed. In order to confirm the charges, the prosecutor brings what he calls the document containing the charges, which is a long document where he explains this person has committed crimes against humanity, war crimes, has committed act of rape here and there as a crime of against humanity, explains the whole case, and also gives a mode of liability. This person is co-perpetrator, this person is an accomplice, this person was the superior giving orders. So she brings the document, and this is where the problem is. This is where the problem really lies, is that then for the confirmation hearing, there is a period where the prosecutor presents evidence, and the defense can also present evidence. The defense is not obliged because the burden of proving something is on the prosecutor, but normally the defense will present evidence as well. So the risk of becoming a trial is really very, very important because we are discussing evidence and there's going to be a confirmation hearing, and then both parties are there, they can bring witnesses. So the risk of getting too far in this pre-trial phase was very, very, very real. So, in any case, the pre-trial deals with the confirmation hearing. If the pre-trial is persuaded, it will issue a confirmation decision. This confirmation decision is when the trial chamber is persuaded that there are substantial, now it's not reasonable, now it's substantial grounds to believe that the person has committed the crime. And issues the confirmation decision, pre-trial ends, and you go into trial. Now, what were the problems? The problems were, first, long period of confirmation with evidence, and everybody was saying this is not a trial, this is not a mini trial before the trial. Everybody recognized in principle that the center of gravity should go to the trial, but still the preparatory phase was extremely lengthy. Second, the chamber would say this person is a perpetrator or this person is an accomplice, one mode of liability. Then they would go to the trial with a confirmation decision that it was very difficult to understand. So it was not readily good to serve as the basis for the trial. So the trial starts after more months of preparations. For instance, in the first case, in the Lubanga case, the after months of pre-trial, 22 months of preparation of trial. Why this? Because among other issues, the confirmation decision is not sufficiently clear. So the entire process starts again. The prosecutor is requested to present an amended document containing the charges in order to understand what is the trial going to be about. So despite the fact that the decision of the judges had to be the basis, the parameters of the for the case, once we were in trial, the trial judges started the whole thing anew. So what do we do in order to improve the system? First, we try to improve the format. And in order to do that, we need to start with the prosecutor. We ask the prosecutor to change the format of his own document. On the basis of this new format, the chambers issued a new type of decision where the charges are very clear and they are differentiated from other aspects in the document. Second, we decide that instead of confirming one mode of liability, we confirm alternative modes of liability. So we don't say this man is a perpetrator. We say this man could be a perpetrator, an accomplice, or other modes of liabilities that we find in the statute. So we leave leeway to the trial phase to determine all these issues. Because in the absence of these alternative modes of liabilities, what were they? The trial judges were doing recourse to the this regulation 55 that I mentioned before, that allows the chambers to change the legal characterization of facts. And that is what they did more and more in order to have this flexibility. So we decided to do this at the pre-trial phase, and then we also did more than that. We tried collectively with all judges and not just one chamber to look into the proceedings and see whether we could propose some changes in the practice. So I became president of the court in 2015, and then I proposed my fellow judges to go all together into a retreat to discuss 3 days procedures, and to discuss in particular pre-trial proceedings. I don't know if you understood anything of what I said before, but it is extremely complicated, because not all the judges have experience in this. The trial judges don't understand the problems of the pre-trial. The pre-trial judges don't necessarily understand the needs of the trial. Some of the judges are new, because in addition to all these socializing judges, every 3 years we have a third of the bench that is replaced. So you need to integrate them again. So I took the opportunity that I was the president and convened a retreat just a few weeks after the new judges joined, and we went together to discuss among ourselves, 18 judges, proceedings of the ICC, this hybrid system. We went to Nuremberg, and very moving, because we had this retreat in the room 600 where the Nuremberg trial took place. They allowed us to have a retreat of judges in this room that inspired history. And actually, it was very moving for the interpreters as well. We took interpreters, you know, the working languages of the court are English and French. And they put the booths for the interpreters in exactly the same place where the booth of the interpreters of the Nuremberg Tribunal had been, which was the first international tribunal that had to deal with simultaneous interpretation. So for the interpreters, it was also extremely interesting historical experience. So we had our own, we had a retreat. We discussed these pre-trial proceedings. We discussed some of the issues I tried to convey to you on alternative modes of liabilities, on the format for the confirmation, the document confirming the charges, how to reduce the time that we spend in pre-trial, but then from pre-trial to trial, transition to trial. And we came with some agreements. And these agreements were reflected in a manual. We decided to, instead of proposing amendments, which are extremely difficult to do, we propose to, we agreed to have this manual where every single agreement on how to proceed, we identify best practices and we try to say, well, this is the practice we should all follow. We put it in the manual. And the manual is public. Everybody can have access to this manual, which is in the website of the court. And there you can see all the agreements among judges on how they are going to proceed in their cases. Without amendments, it's identifying the best practices, and instead of going separate ways, we try to harmonize to avoid this discrepancy, which also affects predictability and certainty of our cases. So we had this, at the beginning it was basically pre-trial. The entire manual was called pre-trial manual, Chambers. But it was a successful exercise. Many of the things that are in the manual for pre-trial also reflect the jurisprudence of the pre-trial chambers before, at least which were identified as best practices. But then, in light of this good experience, which was also unprecedented, because it was the first time that judges accepted that discussing altogether procedures was not in detriment of their judicial independence. Because it, when I arrived into the court, chambers would not talk between them, because they thought, well, each chamber has to deal with a different case, and you are not supposed to discuss your case with other judges. But here we were not discussing cases. Of course, the experience of cases is essential, but it was discussing among colleagues how to improve the system. So we issued the manual, and the second year, 2016, we had a second the retreat. This time we didn't go so far. We just stayed in the Netherlands. We went to Limburg. And there we had 2 days discussing on trial issues, which was less dramatic in terms of breakthrough. But still, we managed to clarify certain issues, and they were reflected in the manual, which became, it was not a pre-trial chamber manual anymore, it became the chambers, manual. So it's not just pre-trial, it's pre-trial and all type of proceedings. And the third and last retreat, at least under my mandate, was in 2017, last year, we went to Krakow, Poland, where we had a discussion on appeals issues. So if you look into the manual, you will see quite an interesting product that tells you how to proceed in the different phases, and in particular pre-trial, the format of the, in pre-trial, basically since the moment that an arrest warrant is issued and the confirmation decisions, the format of the of the confirmation decision, it does say very, very clearly that we should not have live evidence in pre-trial. We should not try to bring the witnesses unless it is absolutely fundamental, but basically to have just written proceedings so we can go faster. We do have a hearing, but the hearing should be 2-3 days, no more. Then we also say the center of gravity is the trial, not the pre-trial. So all these discussions on the culpability of the person should be in the trial, and the pre-trial should be just a filter to decide which are the cases that go to trial, as opposed to cases that are not good enough to go to trial. But also we say that the trial judges should not stand anew. They should really accept the systems that are brought to them, so in order to also gain time, because each phase is part of one process, and we should not start reinventing the wheel at every step of the road. And some of course, the manual is not binding. The manual is not binding. The manual is just a recommendation. It's just, it's not applicable law as such. It's really what the judges at a certain point of time consider to be the best practices to follow. And some of it will become still not totally binding, but more solid when also it's confirmed by jurisprudence, and lots of the things that are in the manual have been already confirmed by jurisprudence, and they're very interesting recent decisions that have confirmed some of these aspects, in particular on the pre-trial-trial relationship. For instance, for those of you who are interested, there is this decision on the 9th of March 2018, which is very recent, on one case, again, of Bemba et al., which is the first case of the court on offenses against the administration of justice. And they're very interesting decisions, findings by the chamber on issues of pre-trial, the document containing the charges, and so forth. So So I lost track of everything I wanted to say. During this time, in addition to pre-trial, we also, I don't know how much time I do I have?
Time you want.
Yeah, two more hours, three more hours. No, I wanted to go because I focused a lot in pre-trial, and I also wanted to go into something that is extremely important for you, which is the system, which I also mentioned. There's a huge innovation in the Rome Statute about victims' participation and reparations. Again, a very complicated, for me, extremely fundamental aspect of the Rome system, which gives rights to victims to participate and seek reparations. Now, we are talking about massive crimes where you have thousands of victims. So when you say we give them the right to participate, you have to understand the logistics behind. First, you need to make sure that victims that may be far away in affected communities in other continents need to understand what is going on in the area. That is one of the main problems that international criminal justice has, is that by definition, the proceedings take place in distance, a long distance from the where the victims are located. So you need to make an extra effort to reach out to them so they understand what you're doing, why you're doing this, why it's important for them, so they take also ownership of the system. So the court was not particularly good at the beginning. We were all testing the system, but with time, it has become much more efficient in the way the court reaches out to victims, identify victims, and allows them to apply and participate. We're talking about thousands of victims. In the initial proceedings until now, we have some 14,000 victims that have participated in proceedings. 5,000 of them are participating in one of the latest trials at the court. For instance, the case in Ongwen, which is a case of a national from Uganda, allegedly from the Lord Resistance Army. So we are talking about thousands of victims that need to be given a voice in the system. Now, victims, first of all, they need to apply. They need to apply to participate. And that on its own was already a logistical problem. And there was a huge backlog at the court, thousands of victims that could not be processed in time. So we have simplified and harmonized the system of applying. And that is in the manual. If you go into the manual, you will see there is a system that we say, well, this is the system of application. The form that they need to fill is much simplified, and the way they do it is simplified. So that this is the first step, apply. Then you need to participate. You do it through legal representatives. Now, legal representatives, basically lawyers, that creates another huge problem. Challenge, I would say, more than a problem. You need to make sure that this legal representative really carries the voices of the victims that are far away. You always have the problem of the lawyers need to carry the voice of their client. Well, here we're talking about thousands of victims that they are participating through a lawyer, through a legal representative that will express for them their views and concerns in the proceedings. Remember that I told you at the beginning, in the regulations of the court, the judges created the Office of Public Counsel for Victims, OPCV. So there is a possibility that they represent victims themselves. But then, of course, the victims can also, they also have the possibility of having external representatives, lawyers that do not work at the court, but they are independent lawyers that can be chosen. So the court has been trying both systems, have been providing legal representation through OPCV, has also given the possibility of representation through external counsel. In the case I mentioned, Ongwen, you have both. If there is a group of victims, let's say half of the 5,000 that are being represented by lawyers of the OPCV at the court, and the other half through external counsel. So this is something that is one of the challenges ahead, is to continue looking into what is the best system for legal representation, and you have different systems in different chambers. So here we continue to have some discrepancies, basically because we are also testing the system and also because victims have the choice. So we have tried hybrid systems where we have a mix of external and internal. So there is a different possibilities, but I don't think the discussion has ended, and this is something that needs to continue. And then, this is participation. Then, once, if a person is convicted, you need a conviction, then victims can seek reparations. You need a convicted person. Remember, we are a criminal court, not a human rights court, so reparations are against the convicted person. So here again, we are talking about thousands of victims that may want reparations. So organizing a system that is genuine, that is effective, and that does provide some remedy in real terms is not easy, and the court is testing the system only now that we have more and more convictions. So we have reparations proceedings in 3 or 4 cases where you had convictions. And each chamber has been proposing a different system. So, and already the system itself provides options, because you, in some cases, you may give individual reparations to each victim. When you have only a number of victims, a very reduced number, but you can also have collective reparations or a combination of both. One very good example of a combination of both is in a recent case in Mali, a Mali situation in the case of the destruction of cultural property in Timbuktu. This is an interesting case because we are not talking about harm, crimes against humanity, against individuals. We are talking about destruction of property, cultural property, that belongs to whom? Here it is argued that it affects the entire community. So you have collective reparations to the community itself, but you also have some individual reparations to individuals that were directly affected by this destruction because, for instance, they worked in some of these monuments. So there are different systems, but that, of course, there is a lot of issues there, but because you need to identify the harm, you identify the victims who suffered harm, you need to determine what is the link, what is the type of reparations you want to give, project, collective project, what type of project, who is going to do it, who is going to implement it. Remember, the court there is a trust fund for victims that is part of this reparation system. The trust fund for victims is an autonomous body. It's not part of the court as such, but it's, of course, linked to the system. And a lot of these reparation systems are giving more and more work and duties to this trust fund for victims, which is independent. And of course, this huge, obvious question is resources. In order to give reparations, you need most of the time resources, and lots of resources, because in most cases we are talking about indigenous people. When you're talking about the convicted persons, most of them have not identified or identified the assets, so the real reparation will have to come from the trust fund. So this is all being tested. So probably it is too early to have lessons learned. It is far too early to have a manual, but you can see in the jurisprudence of the court that more and more experience is being collected on this. And hopefully we are getting there. I believe that the role of victims is very challenging for the court. It was extremely controversial during the negotiations. It continues to be controversial today. Some say, well, work of the court should be retributive justice. You know, the accused, the criminal process against the accused, forget the rest. Well, the rest is part of the system, and I believe it's a huge and fundamental part of the system to ensure impact for the criminal proceedings. So here I stop before I'm fired, but I wanted to tell you that it's been very fascinating for me to be able to address you on these issues. And you see that the system is not easy. There are a lot of advantages of having a hybrid system. I don't think we would have otherwise. But of course, lots of it needs still yet to be tested in a young institution, and some of the challenges will need to be confronted in the years ahead. So thank you very much.